calling this regular meeting, Common Council, Town of Quartzsite, to order at 7 p.m. Tuesday, July 28, 2015. Anyone in the audience who wishes to give the invocation tonight?
Sue Ellen Pennington from the First Assembly of God Church. Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight asking that this meeting go in your direction, whatever that may be, Heavenly Father, that the right words are spoken, that there's no anger of any sort, Lord, or you know the way to go, Heavenly Father. So tonight we're just asking for all your blessings, Heavenly Father. And Lord, please guide everyone, direct everyone, all in your loving Son, Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I'll lead us in the pledge tonight.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please call the roll.
Mayor Ed Foster.
Here.
Vice Mayor Don Simpson.
Here.
Councilmember Carol Kelly.
Here.
Councilmember Loretta Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Hal Davidson.
Here.
Councilmember Mark Bargeron.
Here.
Councilmember Benny St. Germain.
Present.
Okay. First is call to the public.
Sir, if I may. The town clerk is absent tonight because she is enjoying her first and new grandbaby. Yesterday, her daughter gave birth to the grandbaby.
Okay. I don't know. That comes under announcements next time. But I will let it go this time, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
All right. Anyone call to the public? Call to the public. Any announcements, community event, other than births of grandchildren?
Greetings, Mayor and Council. Shanana Rain BearCat. I just wanted to let you all know that if any of you missed Saturday, we had a group of 25 people. It was organized by our new youth council to do the National Dance Day, and it was over at the community center, and we had 25 adults to kids, little kids participating. It was so fun. It has been registered with Dizzy Feet Foundation. The video is up online on YouTube, and you can go see it. It would be under my website, Desert Messenger on Facebook. You can find the link there. And in 2 days, less than 2 days, we've had over 80 some odd views on it. And so I just want to say congratulations to the kids for putting this on. It was really nice to see, even though it wasn't absolutely perfect like some of the professional dancers out there, it was so sweet. And it was really fun to witness. So you guys missed it. Well, I bet we're
going to
do it next year.
Thanks. Anyone else? Okay. Next. Presentation of Quartzsite motion proposed community programming for the Quartzsite Community Center.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and Town Council. Thanks again for the opportunity last month. We shared an idea for a possible new public and private partnership. We labeled Quartzsite in Motion. And the goal of that partnership was basically to create the opportunity for new year-round indoor health, fitness, family, and social activities for residents and guests in the Quartzsite area, focusing on the community center. If you can jump forward just a slide, too. As I mentioned before, we do have a team representing different people from different areas. We have some health and fitness experts. We have some youth program and youth council representatives, some business leaders. Actually, Mr. Kim Scott just volunteered his time to advise us through the process, which we're really grateful for. And of course, Gunny and St. Germain and Mr. Miller have been very helpful in giving us some guidance. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I'm not sure which one it is, a team volunteered me to be the spokesperson, and I don't have any previous experience in talking to a town council, so if I make mistakes, I hope you at least let me know.
We have very little experience as a town council.
We didn't throw anything at me last time, so that's a good thing. But no, if I do make a mistake, please forgive me. This is a little bit of a new environment for me. So we do have a pretty good team, and like we said, we have some really good existing programs in Quartzsite. There's some really great things happening, but they're very specific to specific groups. They're very limited size and limited duration. And what we're trying to do is we really see the opportunity to increase those activities, making the community center a focal point, not just for civic pride, but for a place that youth and adults and families want to go to and go to together. And that's kind of the goal. We're talking about not 7 days a week, but trying to offer indoor programs and activities 6 days a week, or 6 days a week, every week of the year, all year round, as many as 20 to 25 programs a week running there 6 days. So there's a wide range of all types of classes. The biggest thing, it has to offer something for everybody, all ages and abilities, and as Guy and I talked about, also people with disabilities. And of course, it has strict guidelines. The reason I'm here today really is we had a few questions after the presentation last month, and we wanted to clarify a couple questions that were asked we didn't have the answers to after the meeting, and also ask a couple questions to the council if it's possible. So if we jump to page 8, one of the, you might have some paper copies in front of you.
I held off just because we didn't have enough copies.
Okay. Yeah, my apologies, I ran out of printer ink. But there was a question about certifications. Why are we certifying and how are we certifying? And any instructor, we would like to have as many as 8 to 10 instructors participating in the program. Why? Because success can't be based on one individual and needing to offer diversity and variety. Certifications would come in three parts that we see. First, if somebody's teaching, say, Zumba or dance or a Tai Chi class, they got to have a certification from a national body. We should also be certified in group exercise and healthy living is something that we could offer here for them. And then, of course, I imagine the city might have some type of specific training, whether it's safety, legal, other type of training that we might want to factor in. But every instructor would have to have three certifications before they could set foot and teach. We wanted to have a diverse instructor team, which would actually will take some work, but isn't the biggest challenge. There are existing certified instructors year-round here today. Of course, we have a lot of seasonal certified instructors that come in, but the part that excites me the most is that we could turn to some of the youth and young adults or older adults in the community and offer training and certification so they could get involved. So we'd like to see the instructor team, if we could make this joint partnership go, be a diverse collection of different people and different experiences. So if you go on to page 9, there were four modifications, really. The biggest one, far above beyond, is the floor. Modifying the floor so it's shock absorbent and safe was a big one. The other ones, the mirrors, the sound system, the miscellaneous equipment, from a budget standpoint, is way down in the noise. It's hardly noticeable. But we're talking about modifying in the center. I didn't have a good answer for you. But those are the four things that we wanted to modify. And what's a successful modification? First, that it would provide a safe environment for what we're trying to do, that it preserves the multi-purpose nature of the community center room. And I got to tell you, that's the hard one. If you ever, any of you ever gone into a fitness center, there's a reason why they say no street shoes in the fitness areas. But believe it or not, we actually found that I've learned a lot more about floors than I'd ever cared to in the last month. But I do think we have some good solutions. Of course, we can't do anything to hurt the integrity of the building, and we want to keep it aesthetically appealing. And if you move on to page 10, sir, sorry for the eye chart, but when we went out to 5 companies, and we asked for their advice. We spent a lot of time, multiple phone calls with each, and we talked about our requirements. And our requirements are actually listed at the top, that would meet DIN shock absorbent standards for safety, meet ADA non-slip, be antibacterial, no harmful chemicals for kids, support the multi-purpose activities, easy to clean and maintain, and maintain the aesthetics of the community center. And we actually found 3 companies that we focused our discussions on right now. And if anybody's interested, the websites are on this page. Mr. Miller also gave you a copy of an emailable document if you want to share it with everybody. And our contacts by first name or first and last name at each of the companies. So we actually came up, if you look at kind of the bottom middle of that, there's actually five types of floors. You can do regular old regrind mats. These are recycled tire mats that you see in a lot of gyms. They're pretty nice and really low cost. You can go all the way up to multi-layer synthetic mats to multi-layer mats that have poured ethylene on top of them. And cushioned wood floors and suspended wood floors. Just so you know, the average cost to do the community center ranged from probably from about $10,000 on the left to $500,000 on the right. So there's a very wide price range there. So if we jump on to the next, and I just color-coded this green, yellow, and red. Obviously green being good, yellow being marginal, and red being not good for what we're trying to accomplish or suggest be accomplished here. And if you really look at it, the better options come out to be the multi-layer mats and the multi-layer mat and poured. The big difference there is that the poured mats, ballpark, probably about $14,000 to do a multi-layer mat and about an extra 30% to do a poured mat. But the poured mat is the new, I think I gave you a sample, I don't know if you want to pass it around. What's interesting about that actually are, the three companies we're looking at, by the way, have been in business for quite a while. Most of them have products on the GSA schedule, if that's of any benefit to the city. And the multi-layer poured, they actually use this for basketball courts. It's used in the military, residential, commercial. The company that did this one, they did, I think, close to 2 million square feet at the London Olympics with this material, both for recreation areas as well as competition areas. So these companies have a lot of experience. This was interesting because high schools use this around the country now for their basketball courts. They have to put chairs, tables, put bleachers on top of them. They have dances and street shoes. So when I heard all that, we kind of focused on this. Now the only challenge with this, it's a beautiful, seamless poured floor on top of a mat. They advertise that it will outlive the life of your building, whether I believe that or not, I don't know. But where was I going with that? It's very aesthetically appealing. It's offered in different colors. The only challenge is, what I wanted to get to was, we can't install that ourselves. So there couldn't be a community build on that part of the project. Because it's a poured chemical, it does require professionals to come in.
Now how thick is that?
It's roughly...
Is that going to be the actual thickness?
That is the actual... Actually, the thickness for us might be a little thinner. If you take a look, actually, at page 19, if we could jump forward there real quick, the base mat on this ranges from 19.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, no, pulling away.
Yeah. The base is about, it ranges anywhere from a quarter inch to a half an inch. The company is recommending, based upon what we're talking at, that we would be about 8 to 9 millimeters. Who's good with math? That's about a third of an inch. So it'd probably be slightly smaller, thinner than what you're looking at there.
Because the type of floor that we have on there now would be removed.
Laminate tile, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. So how would that meet as far as the doors?
Actually, the
entrance and exits.
We should have the clearances there. I mean, we may have to do a small modification to the lip as you go in, but I think the doors can be modified to accommodate that. We haven't changed the samples over there just yet, but you know, this is a fairly common retrofit.
The good news is we're moving. What'd you call the floor in there? What's the actual material?
I believe they're just, I believe it's just tiles. It's just laminate tiles.
Yeah, and that would have to be removed, and that would be actually included in the budgetary numbers you see. The reason is that the mat actually has to be adhered to concrete, so, and the company would do that. They're actually, we provide the service out of California, so it's not so far away.
That actually might be where we might be able to get the community build back in, or at least town staff could gut the building. If, you know,
it's a possibility.
So, save on demolition.
So if we jump back to page 11, the two that really popped out were the multi-layer mats. You know, the regrind mats are a great solution. What's wonderful about them, you could probably buy three floors for the price of one poured floor. And the nice thing is we could repair it ourselves. The mat goes back, we rip up the old one, clean the surface, retape it, put it down, let it settle for 24 hours, and we can maintain it. But the problem is you would not be able to put street shoes on that without eventually damaging the the surface and having to replace those every few years. So if we move on to page 12, just a short update on the budget. If we look at that better option, we're looking at the total cost of the project for the initial startup, which is really the modified building, being about $22,000 to $27,000. It'll fall somewhere in between there. If we're lucky, we'll get 22. If we're not lucky, we'll probably get 25, 27.
Just for clarification, sir, that is without the GSA pricing?
That is without the GSA pricing, yes. And I apologize for not having an answer for that one today, but every company has products on GSA, but not all their products are on GSA. Right. So I just need a little more time on that. And of course, we said the monthly costs, you know, if you look at the certified instructors, we would cap their salaries at 20, 30% below Arizona averages, because this is not about people making an income, it's about community. And we would see an opportunity for revenue. And if we could get an extra 300 to 700, that would just be nice to have, because if we're off in our numbers, which we try to keep conservative, if we're off, we have a little bit of cushion or we have an opportunity to invest somewhere else. So if we jump onto the slide 13, I think I only have two more. This is a really the important thing. For this partnership to take off between Quartzsite and Motion, we would really need the town council's approval to modify and use the room under your supervision or your oversight, make sure we're covered for insurance for the classes, promote it through the community, agree with the project guidelines, which is really making it about community. Nobody's to make a profit out of this, and be available for program advice and consultation. And of course, we tried to keep Quartzsite in Motion. If we agreed to do this and we had your support, we would set up a not-for-profit community-based organization called Quartzsite in Motion. Be led by the community, would handle all the fundraising and circular cost admin, so you don't have to do that, but with full transparency to the city and the community. We'd develop and manage the instructor team and publish regular reports. We'd also work with federal and state partners. We actually did already meet with the week after our last meeting. Here, we met with La Paz County Health Department and AmeriCorps. They are very, very interested in what they're doing. They actually have money for Quartzsite right now. Unfortunately, it doesn't apply to the type of programs we're doing. But the good news is there's money they have sitting there waiting to give to Quartzsite if there's some programs that want to be run within their charter for which those funds are given to them. We also are trying to set up meetings with the Parker Area Alliance for Community Enrichment, PACE, and then Simpatico. And we just want to plug into these organizations to see if there's an opportunity for funding, resources of any type to make this easier and to get their support for being part of La Paz County. And the last slide before our questions, really is slide 14. And we look at roughly about 4 to 5 months to get going. Say we got an agreement and we agreed that we wanted to partner to do this and it made sense right now for the town. Once we agreed to partner, we'd probably take 1.5 to 2.5 months to establish the not-for-profit, set up the board and all the vehicles around that to do fundraising. It's not a huge number, it's not a small number, so I don't know how the fundraising would go, but we'd like to be optimistic. We've been networking through the community. We're hoping we, with hard work, we could raise the $22,000 to $27,000 we need. After that, it's really just the modifications, but we think if we agreed to do it, we could have something up and running as early as late November, early December, and actually have programs running. And of course, the thing that excites me the most is, first and foremost, is to focus on this, have indoor activities all year round for individuals, families, and the community, make that community center come alive. But hopefully, if this were to take off, and we should focus just on that sustainability, Quartzsite in Motion could become a springboard to do other things in the community. With the Youth Council and with other groups. And so the real questions I have are really home three on slide 15. Is there a potential interest from the town council to set up a public-private partnership? If no, is there something we could do or questions you have that we could try to address for you? And if yes, how would the way of working be going forward?
I guess my biggest concern would be entering into a partnership like this would be you always want to see what is your bylaws going to be, what's your, as far as your not-for-profit, we want to see everything for that, and then, you know, it is a considerable cost to put this in. Okay, so so we get the money to put it in, then what about the maintenance, the care of it? Whose responsibility is that? Would it be yours? Would it be ours? And then what is the cost of care and maintenance?
The easy question I'll do first is the maintenance. First off, we built in $200 a month for cleaning supplies and materials to maintain the floor. Okay, what does that mean? Is that $200 for cleaning materials and brooms or mops and maybe a little bit of salary to pay somebody to come in and clean? That's possible. That's all I can tell you is we built in $200. With regards to who does it, we need a little bit of advice. You know, again, the hope is here. We're not looking for instructors who are trying to make a living. We're looking for instructors from the heart who want to get community engagement in these programs. If we have to, we'll look for a volunteer. If we have 8 to 10 instructors, every instructor takes a week shift 4 times a year to keep the floor clean twice a week.
And what kind of prices are you looking to charge for individuals wanting to participate? And is that something, have we done a study throughout Quartzsite of the year-round residents? Well, can they, would they support it?
So if we could, I have the answer actually on one of the, well, something that'll help me at least address that for you, sir. Here we go, page 12. If we could go there. The answer is we don't know, but let me tell you what we did to try to get a good estimate in the budget. When we look at the population, right now there's a group out there that does marketing studies on this. It's called the IHRSA. It's the International Paddle Racket Club Sports Fitness Group Association. They provide marketing data all around this country and all around the world on what the averages are for participation and what people pay. Right now they say that 16% of the U.S. citizens pay for memberships in some type of fitness program. Of a population will typically do that. They estimate in Western Arizona and Eastern California that 4% of the population will participate. So I guess it's an idea of membership from the community. I've talked to a couple owners over in Blythe, and they say the same thing, about 3 to 5%. We built the budget based on 2% of the population will participate.
So one that you queried, was that the one that just went out of business?
One of them was, yes. It was John Walker from the Sheriff's Department, who used to ran that for 7 years. And he built his business plan based on having 7 or 8%, and he only was able to hit 3 to 5%.
Yeah.
And he had competition pop up, and that's something to consider. If gyms started popping up all over Quartzsite, then your participation would go down. Now, the other thing that we did too, we know what the population goes to in the winter here. We estimated that, and we're talking about a lot of programs for seniors, Tai Chi, chair yoga, a lot of programs in the morning and the winter hours when kids are in school and can't participate there for the winter residents. We estimated that only 100 of all those tens or hundreds of thousands of people who come here, only 100 of them will join. Now, if more than 100 participate, we can take that extra money and use it to offset it for youth and families in the community. We're trying to be, that's the best I can answer your question, sir, is that we try to be very conservative. The hope is we'll get more than 100, we'll get 200. We get 200, then we can take those membership fees and use it to offset and provide full transparency to the town council and the community on that. I mean, I'd like to, I think, and if you look around Arizona too, we did look, the average community center costs float anywhere from $20 to $50 a month for an adult and about $15 to $25 for a young person. We stay well below that for these estimates as well. We don't know what it will be. We don't have a crystal ball, but that's how we came up with the numbers we put into the budget.
Have you looked at maybe a corporate type membership for businesses?
No.
Basically for their employees from X number from 0 to 5, 6 to 10, having different pricing availability for that?
No, we didn't. Actually, we kept the budget pretty simple initially. And of course, if we do that, that'll bring down the average cost, the average contribution of membership per person. But we didn't really do that because we're trying to keep the budget simple. But we do want to go back, and Mrs. Warner also suggested that we look at families. We do plan on doing that. We just didn't want to make the budget a 3-slide presentation on how memberships are structured because they can get really sophisticated. But a corporate membership is a great idea. Company membership, family memberships would be essential because that's a big goal here, to get families involved together.
Any other questions?
Yes. How would this impact, I didn't
center now for local events. What are your ideas? Are you going to be like a 9-to-5 thing and our locals are going to have a little bit of a problem where they have their meetings and this type of thing?
Well, I would say that there's, let me get one reference here. Could you go to the rough schedule there, Mr. Miller, page 6? Okay, first off, right now what we have are a few specific programs, like the youth program that just finished, the High Jolly Youth Program, really great program around for 8 weeks. We're talking about programs 6 days a week, every week of the year, indoor. We understand it's a multi-person building, and when there's a graduation, there's a social event, the city rents out, classes have to be canceled. All we have to do is provide, and that's not an impact. We're talking about going from an average of probably 20, 30 classes a year up to maybe 1,000 classes a year. If we have to cancel 10% of those classes because there's 10% schedule conflicts, it's still a huge improvement. And we would figure that those type of activities would take priority. And that, of course, would not be, Quartzsite in Motion wouldn't want to have the authority to determine what takes priority in the community center. We would just like to have a little bit of authority to determine, you know, that we keep costs where they're supposed to be and that people aren't profiting from these youth programs. I don't know if that answered the question.
Well, we do birthday parties, graduations, retirements. We do bountiful baskets. Whenever we have a meeting for an event, it's there. We use it quite a bit.
Yeah. If you take a look here, and this is based on a lot of experience. If you take a look at the Blythe Rec Center, which runs a pretty good program, and you take a look at gyms, there are prime times in the day that work the best for the people coming out of work, kids coming out of school in the winter, kids in the morning, in the summer, or in the winter. Our visitors love morning classes. They hate afternoon and evening classes. They love morning classes. So this gives you an idea of what a typical, you know, this is just a sample. It's not intended to be actual, but typically from like anywhere from 8 to 11 in the morning, there might be classes certain days of the week, and then after school in the summer, starting right after school lets out, to maybe classes from 5 to 7-ish, plus or minus a little bit. And, you know, I guess my question is, how much is the building going used? That's something I don't have enough of a handle on right now. But I would assume is that if we committed to do this, and we're running 20 to 25 classes a week, which is about more than 1,000 a year, that we might have to cancel 5 or 10%. But still, we're giving an opportunity for individuals, families, and youth in the community that wasn't there before. We just have to have that way to communicate that.
Our community center was open 11 hours today. And you know, I'd be surprised if we had 3 people.
My big concern would be the children's summer program that we have.
Yes.
Because we can't lose that. That was just unbelievable this year, and we want it to continue. You know, that's just amazing what Mrs. Miller and everybody did. And the children were great. So that's something that would, to me, would be a priority for the community center in the summertime.
I agree, extremely valuable program. And there would be, of course, in the charter, as you mentioned, sir, there just have to be a simple protocol. We would not want to have that authority because we can't determine from our perspective what the best opportunity is for the town. So we wouldn't want that, and we would have no problem getting instructors who had to give up classes a dozen a year if they had to.
You know, that's roughly a 6-week program that we do. We block off the 6 hours per day, and we can accommodate classes in the afternoons and evenings during that time period. Same thing with our after school program. We would have the facilities for the tutoring and enrichment, and we just block that time off.
Great.
Could you talk a little about the exercise equipment? It's mentioned briefly, and then I see in the seniors 55 plus, boxing and awesome abs. I don't do much boxing anymore, and my abs are beyond help. So.
I have a good friend, his name's Randy Gordon, he's in New York State, he was the former New York State Boxing Commissioner. The biggest class he ran at the World Gym on Long Island was boxing for seniors, and what it was aerobic boxing. It was light to music, light movements, it wasn't contact. As a matter of fact, I would recommend to the city that there be no contact sports as a part of this program to be allowed in the community center. Because you create more risk, more liability, you need a lot more oversight in the people and the programs. But when we talk about things like boxing and kickboxing, what we're talking about is aerobic non-contact, where we teach people proper technique, but all they're hitting is air.
Would you have any of the strengthening equipment for legs, arms, and the typical gym equipment? That's one of the things that seems to be a good item for seniors to get the strengthening. Most of this is the dance type, just movement, but you're not planning on having any equipment in it?
Well, first off, there is some equipment there today, but of course it's limited, but it's really a great start. It's good equipment, it's clean. For the actual, like the group exercise parts of this program, we're only talking about needing about two-thirds of the floor. That leaves a third of the floor, say, along the eastern wall, or the northeastern wall, available for equipment. And Quartzsite in Motion could grow into that. They could grow into becoming a source to generate the funds necessary to expand the equipment. As part of the initial, we'd like to expand it a little bit. But the answer is yes, but one thing we're trying to do, we don't want to try to be everything to everybody at once up front, because our biggest concern, it's in one of our program guidelines, is to make sure we have a sustainable success. Once we're there, we can build on it. If the council says that weightlifting equipment is a prerequisite, then we could look at that. From a standpoint of the advisors on Quartzsite Motion, we talked about it. We'd like to take one step at a time. And we've been tempted. Every time we talk about we could do this, we could do that, we could do this. And it's all focused around health and fitness. But it's a good point. And for seniors who don't want to do it, there's some programs that are offered, like Tai Chi and chair yoga. We can't teach martial arts for the blind if we want. We have two instructors in town that could do that. But for people who want to do strength conditioning for older folks that would benefit from that, we don't have a plan yet.
Anything else?
No, I'm good to go.
Thank you, sir.
Well, just one question I had. Is there any interest at this time for support of a private partnership, which was my question on slide 15? And if no, is there other things that you need us to do or to research or come back?
Really, there's no action to be taken on this agenda item. It's just a discussion only, so you really can't take a vote as past council.
I don't think we need to do a vote or even a... But is there any concern at this point from council? There is a community group that's trying to move forward and provide council additional information. Do you, as speaking for yourselves, is there any roadblocks that you see to the group moving forward to one day coming in front of you?
I follow directions. I stated my concerns.
Yes, you did. Thank you, sir.
I think it would work well if we can implement it and get the community behind it. And you've made a very good presentation. You did a good job.
Thank you, sir. I'm just wondering why we haven't got it started yet. I ain't gonna lie.
You write the check, he'll start tomorrow.
You got it, just don't cash it.
My only concern was where was the money coming from. I really appreciated the contribution you made to the summer youth program. That was a real good start to show that what you could do in the community. So.
A lot of good people. I just would need some guidance a little bit later then, just on what to do. But thank you again for the opportunity to share.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Next, consent agenda. I would like to remove check number 39170 and to also move the item number 3 off the consent agenda for discussion.
I'd like check number 39163 also.
Anybody else? Do we have a motion?
I'm sorry, what was that on number 3?
Number 3, I'd just like to pull it out of the consent agenda and take it to the regular agenda for discussion.
All right.
Yeah, but it's in the consent agenda. That's really have to be discussed. Anyhow, now we have two checks.
I move that we approve the ledger accounts paid, less checks 39170 and 39163.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the ledger of account, minus check 39170 and 163. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Next is the minutes. Consider approval of minutes of the regular meeting of July.
You want to go to those checks?
Well, that's, this is still part of the consent agenda. I thought minutes were consent, aren't they?
No, that's under administrative.
All right, okay, then we'll go back to the checks. Check number 39170, I actually have an answer to it, but I needed an answer. If I needed an answer, someone out there may need an answer, so I'm going to bring it up. So Mr. Miller, they asked the question, what was it for and why? Okay?
All right. Are we on 163?
170 first.
170 first, okay. Oh, okay. This is the annual service contract we have with Conica Minolta Business, Minolta Business. This is our multifunction printer. It's our main printer for the administration building. It is broken up into four sections. That's, for Department of Budgeting purposes. That's shared by Utilities Administration, Admin, Planning, Zoning, Finance. But it is for one lease machine, multi-year lease, and the annual on that is $1,658.12.
Okay.
And we're locked into that lease right now.
Someone had questioned me in the community, and I needed that answered out in public, so, all right. Check number 39163.
Okay, I just got a couple of questions. All these fuel, is it from our tank out here and they're just splitting it up?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
The way this is allocated, we end up filling that tank, I'm going to say roughly every 45 days. We go about a month and a half on the fuel purchase that we do. Depending on the time of year, sometimes a little slower, sometimes faster. But the system out there, each individual employee has an employee identifier, and each vehicle has a number. So when you go out there, you plug in your employee ID, you plug in your vehicle, and it tracks usage by department that way.
Okay, my second question is, right now, oil is at a six-year low. How's the prices been going? Still up like all the gas stations in town? I think so, that should be looked at, because I check these things on a daily basis, and right now, it's at a six-year low. It's under $50 a barrel. I think the gas prices should be going down. You might check into that and see.
We have a contractor, can you buy it on the spot market, whatever price?
We actually have multiple vendors that we look at to determine who has the cheapest pricing. So, and we are getting a cheaper price than what we would do at the pump.
Okay. Then I have a motion to approve these two checks.
I move we approve check 39163 and 39170.
Moved and seconded to approve check 39163 and 170. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. Okay. Appointment of two police, Quartzsite police officers.
You said you moved that down.
That's now, we're in the back to regular agenda minutes or in the administration, so we can do this. Appointment of two Quartzsite police officers. Consider approval to appoint a Quartzsite police department officer and approved and vacant positions. I wanted to discuss this. We have two qualified approved applicants at this time.
Actually, clarification on that, sir, too, if you want to. We have two vacant positions right now. One is due to the resignation of Officer Solomon Hall. And as Chief has stated in the past, he did have an open seat, an open position that was originally planned for an academy candidate. However, it's been decided that we're going to move forward with two laterals. The first Chief Mayor.
Mayor, Council, thank you. Chief Ray Renfro. We have two vacancies due to what Tyler just described. One of the candidates has about 8 years on. He's got a pretty honorable record. He's passed all the background phases, and we're ready to move forward to offer him a position with the approval for the purse for the council.
Can you define pretty honorable?
Well, he's I'm sure he'll get Googled many times here at Quartzsite. So he's got a great record. He's a canine. He was nominated officer of the year down at Cocoa Paw. He's a really good kid. So pretty excited to have him. You know, he interviewed really well, and he's real well liked down.
So it's not pretty good. It's actually pretty great.
I'm excited. When I get excited, that's good. So.
Yeah, but you sort of gave him the
eye. Yeah.
Just using your words.
Yeah, okay, I will.
Our.
What I've seen so far, he seems to be an excellent candidate for Quartzsite.
One other question. I was told the other day that this request is a response to the fact that your department has a lot of overtime with current staffing.
Yes.
And I asked you then to be prepared tonight to tell us how much overtime.
That was just actually passed out to you, Mayor.
Yeah. If you'll look at the page one of that, we had Ms. Kiki Tunnel pull up our overtime in the last quarter from April to the end of June.
And passed out.
You'll see where overtime is separated by overtime and grant money, GOHS. The overtime we've spent is 497 hours. For my entire staff. Now we're down to six officers and myself, seven employees. If you remember correctly, we went down, we started off when I took over with 13 funded positions. Council wanted to move down to 10, and because I did that for the sake of promoting the lieutenant. And so we're not at 10, we're only at seven right now, including myself. So we're pretty understaffed. We have an officer safety concern. We've got one officer per shift. So we would like to fill those positions so we can at least be back up to full staff.
Are you still doing the one that we're sending to the academy?
No, sir. She has been removed from the consideration.
Okay, so you've got the one lateral that you said was coming from Cocoa Paw.
Yes, and then we have another lateral that's in the actual background process. Sorry, I didn't tell you that, but he's going through it now. I don't know if we'll have any. We'll wait to see what happens, but he seems like a good candidate as well. When he finishes his background, I'll get the report and look at it.
Yeah. What we're looking for today with the approval of the consent agenda was first for Chief to explain to you the current status of the department and the two candidates that he is interested in filling those seats with. The council's role in this process, again, is from a budgetary perspective. We would be making the appointment of the first candidate immediately, pending approval of council. The second approval here would be after successfully completing a full background polygraph, and we would not make that offer of employment until that's been fully vetted.
Okay, so what would be the difference in salary versus overtime that we would save on that? Since we're looking at only the budgetary. Because when you tell me that, well, we're only looking at the budgetary, which I agree. But when you tell me that, that says, yeah, there's something else there. So my question is to look a little deeper.
Sure.
So I want to know what's the difference between this person's actual salary versus the overtime that we're saving. And did this guy here previously work with our now lieutenant?
Yes, he did. He worked down at Cocoa Paw again, yes.
So the lieutenant is the one that recruited him?
Yes, he did.
Okay, so back to the dollars now.
Okay. Yes, that's good. We need all the recruiters we can get here at Quartzsite, just because of where we're located. So,
so we're still at dollars.
This guy would putting him on staff right today would cut down on the overtime to some extent, I hope.
Yes, it should. You got to remember, we've had a pretty busy last quarter, too. We We've had some drive-by shootings, we've had some stabbings, we've had a lot of stuff going on. So it's really taken up a lot of our manpower.
But what are we looking at for the cost of this officer is my bottom line question.
Second.
What are we looking at for the cost of this officer?
He'll be at mid-range. I think I don't have the salaries in front of me, but he won't be a starting officer at around 43. He'll be around 46. And that's right where all our other mid-range officers are. $46,000.
No, bottom line, we're looking at saving 40, minimum 40 hours a week overtime, and that's going to save us some serious money. It's already in the budget. We agreed.
Right. I would, at this point, entertain a motion to hire one and reserve on the second until we have another officer qualified or pass the test.
I'm okay with it.
I wouldn't agree with that due to the fact that we're talking financials, and I have all the faith in the world of our town manager and our chief of police. If they are going to hire an individual, that he's going to be well qualified for the position. And since we are short, and we're talking not only the safety of the officers, but the safety of the community, I think the approval for both should go through.
I don't have that, because I would like these two gentlemen here in the public forum to certify that the person they're choosing to do this has passed all of the requirements to be in this other.
Well, personally, I think that they're both staking their job when they tell us that, yes, this person here is qualified, has been vetted, has done this, this, and this, that if they're both going to come up here and lie to us, I guarantee you they won't be employed the next day. So,
I don't understand.
I'm with Gunning, that since we're looking at the budgetary aspect, which is as far as our responsibility goes, these two carry all the other responsibility. I say we do both of them.
The reason I was framing it in that respect is simply because we would be making an immediate appointment of one candidate.
Correct.
And once the background had been fully vetted on the second candidate, then we would make that offer of employment. So even though you're potentially approving two tonight, there would be a slight staggering of their appointments to that position. So we will not bring on somebody that has not completed the full background.
So you're saying if we do approve that, you would make him the offer like tomorrow, huh?
Yeah, we would offer him. I don't think he would start until probably the 6th of August would be the first, because he has to give 2-week notice to his employers, both of them.
The problem is on the second candidate, if we were to wait until the August 11th meeting, there would just be an additional delay to get him on staff.
Right. So when do you expect to have the vetting done on the second officer?
He's finished his background interview. He was supposed to take his polygraph today. He's doing the medical, I believe, on Friday. So probably sometime I'll get the background report next week sometime, probably the end of the week.
We might be doing both then.
Well, the reason I'm not going back, and I'm going to give it one more shot here, to Mr. Bodron's question, the relationship between the lieutenant and this applicant with working at Copacabana.
I just, I asked if one recruited the other one.
Right. Well, but we don't have that opportunity if we go right now. And I would like to see that we wait until the person is qualified.
And what part of the state is this prospective employee currently employed?
Lake Havasu.
Okay. So.
We have a situation. We're a rural community. We're well west of the greater Phoenix area.
I mean, I would have more.
A lot of our candidates are going to be coming from western counties.
You're right, but I mean, I would have more concern. I understand what the mayor's saying, and I would have reason for pause if all of a sudden we're starting to get all. We're going to build our department on Cocopah's back.
Right.
To have knowing Cocopah Police Department, the area. That would be something I would favor.
Sure. And I think we are looking for
this one coming, not a problem. Yeah. Dealing in the Havasu area, I don't have an issue with that.
And something council also needs to think about as well. I economy's coming back, a lot of police agents are starting to hire, you know, their big agencies in Phoenix are really starting to gear up now, and those candidate pools are going to go even lower. So if we wait, the longer we wait, it gives this other candidate an opportunity to look elsewhere and take employment somewhere else. So I'm just saying that that's a thought process that you guys should have as well. We battle with qualified applicants straight across the board in every job here at Quartzsite. And when you get them, I think we should move as quickly as possible, as long as they're vetted, their backgrounds are finished, and we're okay with them.
On the agenda, it says consider approval to appoint a Quartzsite Police Department. Would that be an error that could be corrected?
Well, I think after the comment should be and approved to fill the approved vacant position.
The title does state too, yes.
The agenda a correctable error for the minutes.
Yeah.
So I would vote the way I vote because of the way I said I would vote. So
yes, sir.
Do I have a motion from the floor?
I move that.
Wait a minute.
She's been trying to talk for
2 minutes. I am. You can't do any more except jump up and scream. I think we need to go forth with both of these. Our season is approaching. These new officers need to learn Quartzsite. We need to learn them, know them, know what we can expect. And I think we need, let's not fool around. Let's do this. Let's get our police force up to go. We've only got one on a shift. Yeah.
All right. I move that we approve the appointment of a Quartzsite police officer and to authorize the approval of another vacant position to hire for the approved vacant position.
Aye. Moved and seconded. All in favor, signify by saying aye. We'll do this with a roll call.
Mayor
A.
Foster.
No.
Vice Mayor Norm Simpson.
Aye.
Councilmember Carol Kelly.
Aye.
Councilmember Loretta Warner.
Aye.
Councilmember Hal Davidson.
Aye.
Councilmember Mark Orgeron.
Yes, sir.
Councilmember Penny St. Germain.
Aye. The ayes have it. Moving on. High Jolly Cemetery,
minutes.
Consider approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of July 14th. Do I have a motion, or is there any changes?
I move we approve the minutes of the regular meeting of July 14th, 2015.
Second.
Moved and seconded to approve the minutes of the July 14th meeting and presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Unanimous. Now, High Jolly. High Jolly Cemetery regulations forms. We've discussed this prior to this meeting.
This is just for approval.
This is just for the approval of the forms?
Yep.
So, is there any need for any further discussion at this time? Anyone? If not, I'll entertain a motion to approve the forms as presented.
I move that we approve the amended forms of the High Jolly Cemetery regulation forms as presented before the
entry schedule.
Check.
And the fee schedule, yes. Your support.
Okay. Did I get a second?
Second.
Okay. Move to second to approve the forms and fee schedule as presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. Moving on, discussion and possible action on the IT services. This was discussed, there probably ought to be a little more detail right now. These things were discussed in budget hearings earlier, but now it's ready for approval.
Yes, sir. The companies are, the various vendors, we still have to draft contracts as approved form. What I'm asking
It is. One of the things that we talked about, my goal was to, essentially have our major IT costs. The first item that we talked about was our phone and internet costs. We are currently with TDS, and we are, we are spending over $2,600 between TDS and another vendor for T1 and DSL lines. We're receiving, in total, 32 megabytes per second. What we're proposing to move toward with GovNet, as you can see on the front quote here, is their 100 megabit per second service. So we are essentially tripling our service and having the cost. Now, we will partition this so that approximately, that 60% of the service will be attributed to the library and public spaces. So there will be public access to it. This will be high-speed broadband internet. It will be microwaved in via GovNet. And 40 megabits of that will be allocated for town administration and departmental use. So the 32 megabit that we're utilizing right now, it has a similar breakdown, but unfortunately those devices are fragmented. So just because I say there's 32 megabit available, it doesn't mean that it's fluid and accessible. It's partitioned off. It's 5 megabit here, 1.5 here, and there's no coordination of that. So this is one piece of the larger IT puzzle that we're trying to put together. And again, we're tripling data and having the cost. So this would go down to, since this is e-ratable, even though it's showing $3,000 per month, the town would end up spending $1,380 per month.
The other part is the establishing a relationship with Northern Arizona University.
Yes, sir. That's the second of three pieces that I'm presenting to you today. Northern Arizona University proposed a Category 2 E-rate project for us. That is the enterprise grade access points for this room, the library, and the community center, and also the air bridge, they call it air fiber, to connect all these facilities. That is, I believe that's roughly a $16,000 project. E-rate is going to pay for 85% of that, and we'll be responsible for the additional 15. The good news is that we have received a $4,000 grant from State Library Association. So
is that the
I think so. We have a grant. All right. So, and that constitutes our local match. So, we're talking about $0 out of our general fund expenditures for a $16,000 project that opens up.
And that covers the consortium.
That covers the bridge that we were talking about earlier. This is new. All right. That was a tie-in. So we're not talking about the air bridge tonight. We're waiting for the Category 2 funding to become available so that I can bring that to council at a later time, which should be in the next couple months.
We are establishing a technical relationship.
That's how we were made aware of the Education Technology Consortium. This group also provides comprehensive IT support. That's network maintenance, desktop, break fix, basically everything that we need here. We were originally using a private company out of Havasu, and we were paying on average $4,600 a month for basic break fix services. I've since stopped using them, but the break fix issues and the health of our network is degrading because of it. So we've been
service, I originally proposed another company called Executech, and they were going to provide, they were going to provide primarily remote services, but there was going to be a pool of hours that we were basically purchasing. And they would roll over, but we were limited in the number of hours. We felt it was a reasonable amount to move forward in service, but you never know. That number could go up if we had a major issue, and I didn't want to be up against a storm like that. With Northern Arizona University, we were given an opportunity. They do they work with educational institutions and libraries across the state, and then they do have some community customers as well. But we would probably be their first true government entity that they would be serving, but it's well within their scope. They are proposing a one-time annual cost of $25,000, which is actually less than the Executech, and again, still having the cost of connected computer for comprehensive support, unlimited hours. This covers all labor and support. What it would not cover, just like any of the other companies, is any new hardware purchases or project-driven purchases. So if we need a new computer, we self-purchase a computer. We need a new switch.
But if we needed equipment, we could take advantage of the educational discounts.
Yes. This also gets us into their consortium, and this is another. Just like the State Co. Cooperative Purchasing Group, this is another publicly bid system, and we would enjoy the educational cost breaks. So by being a customer of theirs, part of that is joining the consortium. So we would have another resource pool to find cost effective measures.
The last one is the Crescendo.
Crescendo, yes. This is the phone system that was proposed to us via the E-rate bidding process. We are currently paying just over $2,500 a month for our roughly 40 phones. It's actually $2,511. We are actually leasing the phones. Phones that you see in our offices, the phone that's on your desk, Mayor, those are all leased items, and we have more than paid for those phones, probably a dozen times over by now. What we're proposing to do is move to Crescendo. It's a similar system that we have now, voice over IP. Call quality would go up because of the expanded, the additional bandwidth that we would have with GovNet. But the newer phones, we would purchase those outright at the beginning of the contract. We're looking, again, not to exceed $5,000 in purchasing all new phones and equipment for town. And our monthly cost on that, instead of about $80 per phone, would be just under $13, with the exception of the library phones, which would be E-rated at 90%, so those would be significantly less. At any rate, we're looking at just over $500 per month, so we're going from $2,500 to $500 per month. So we would pay for those phones in 2 months.
Now, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
Having availed myself of the, telephonically attending a meeting, called into this phone and tried to work on over the phone with the meeting, and Mr. Simpson was going like this with and being picked up in the mic here, it just didn't work very well. You can't really hear what's going on in the meeting. Is it possible to have the call-in thing hooked into the sound system so that when you participate or when you listen, you're listening to the sound system?
I'll ask them for additional products to tie into the system itself. I did ask them for a meeting room phone, and they do have specific devices that would be for a conference room.
You are allowed, if I stay allowed, to it's next to useless. You're there, and you're halfway from here, and it just doesn't really work. You're not really attending telephonically.
Yes, sir. I do believe that we would have a significant improvement on teleconferencing. Additionally, and this is down the road, but once we have our additional bandwidth, we could probably even talk about Skyping.
Just as long as somewhere in our future, that aspect of the phone service here that is so poor is improved, I would.
I agree.
And I just want it on the record that I'm asking you.
So again, this was these are three pieces of that larger puzzle. I'm looking to have our IT costs, and this is how we do it.
And improve the service.
And improve the service, yes, sir.
Anybody want to make a motion?
Can you restate the wording of the motion you're requesting?
You do not have three contracts in front of you. You have proposals, and I will be working with the town attorney on this. But what I'm requesting tonight is authorization from council, so a motion that authorizes the town manager to execute agreements with
these three issues.
Yeah, with GovNet, Northern Arizona University Education Technology Consortium, and Crescendo.
Gotcha.
Consistent with the proposals presented.
All right, go ahead, Mark.
I'd like to move that we approve to authorize the town manager to execute agreements with GovNet, Northern Arizona University, ETC, and Crescendo Voice Over Phone.
Second.
Consistent with proposals as presented.
Consistent with the presented proposals.
Thanks, sir. Second.
Moved and seconded to authorize the town manager to enter into agreements for IT as proposed. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Unanimous. Okay. Reports from the mayor. I really don't have anything to report. Are anybody from the council?
Yes. We've had several truck rollovers at the food bank, and I have tons of squash. Please come help me.
Is it squash or is it just squash?
No, we didn't order the food bank, but I have butternut spaghetti and acorn squash, and I think everybody in town has got at least one case, but I've got about 50 more to go. So please, if you know anybody that needs anything, come and get it on Thursday.
Anybody else on the council? No council? Town manager?
Yes, sir. A couple of updates. I'll try and be brief. The Quartzsite Youth Council is finalizing their bylaws so that they can establish themselves as a not a formal body, but I like to use the term like a mock trial, but as a administrative body,
quasi
the rec department, quasi official. Thank you. I believe they're going to be ready for their first meeting that the public will be invited to attend on August 5th. I'm still working with them on a time for that because I believe some of them are back in school already. Additionally, we have five representatives from the group that will be attending the Arizona League Youth Conference on August 19th. And Chief Renfro and his wife had volunteered to chaperone that event. So,
thank you, Chief.
So we will have representatives there, and they will be presenting the flag at the procession of the flags ceremony. Flag ceremony. Next, we have our public hearing for the final budget. That will be August 14th. I believe at 10 a.m. I know at least two of you are going to be teleconferencing in on that, so we will make arrangements and make that as clear as possible for both of you. And once we have the final budget approved, I will be moving forward with the council mobile office program, so the the iPad program for council. So your first digital meeting will be proposed to be on, I believe that's September 5th. No, wait, hang on. Excuse me, September 8th is my goal to have your first digital meeting.
Is that all?
That's all I have, sir.
Okay, motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Moved and seconded, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.